week on Wish You Were Here, I explore a country new to tourism, Namibia, and play Name That Dune. That's in Southern Africa. Nick Knowles is staying in a spectacular resort in Nassau. He must be feeling flush. That's in the Bahamas. Don't let the millennium bug you. We provide a brief guide to the top places to be on the 1st of the year 2000. Judith Chalmers goes to Saint-Tropez to see if it's changed much since she was there in the 70s. And Martin Roberts explores the Costa del Sol from Benal Madena to Torremolinos to Malaga. Travel with us on Wish You Were Here.
Looking for an unusual way to celebrate the millennium? Then come to this extraordinary resort on Paradise Island in the Bahamas and join in the equally wacky New Year's Eve Junkanoo Parade in nearby Nassau.
The Royal Towers promises a total immersion entertainment experience. So, immerse me.
Faster than a speeding bullet, watch me shoot through the shark-filled Predator Lagoon. Inside an acrylic tunnel, of course. This Mayan temple is apparently part of the Atlantis theme of the resort. Don't ask me why. But mostly the place is devoted to water, 11 million gallons of it. There are slides and rides, pools and waterfalls, fountains and lagoons.
I also got a snorkeling lake for the tiger fish. It's great.
In case you didn't get that, I said they've also got a snorkeling lake filled with tropical fish. It's great. And it is too. Thankfully, there aren't any sharks here. They're safe in the Predator Lagoon.
That looks incredibly dangerous, Steve.
Not really. Sharks really aren't all that aggressive. You certainly wouldn't want to stick your hand in their mouth. But other than that, they do pretty... There you go.
He's stroking the shark. Can you believe this? He's stroking the shark.
Talking of sharks, maybe I should ring my bank manager.
If you've got a little bit of extra cash you want to splash out on the coming new year, you might think about hiring the most expensive, most exclusive suite in the hotel. It's the little bit on the bridge that goes between the two towers you can see behind me. It's there, right there on the end of my finger. $25,000 a night. Don't seem to have that much cash on me at the moment.
Service here is sometimes a little slow, but not in this restaurant.
There are several places you can get breakfast around here. This place alone serves 1,000 breakfasts in just 3 hours every morning. And there's everything you could want, from sweet pancakes to stewed fish.
The resort is exclusively for tourists, but a short walk away is Nassau, where real people live, and on New Year's Eve, stage the Bay Street Junkanoo Parade. Last year's winner of the best costume prize was a group, or shack, called the Saxons.
They're going to allow us inside their shack where they build all their different costumes, which is an enormous privilege because it's done in utmost secrecy. Come in and say hello. Hi, you guys.
Hey.
How's it going?
Coming along.
So how important to you guys is it to win on New Year's Day?
Well, it's very important. You know, you have bragging rights for the rest of the year.
And who are the guys you most want to beat?
The Valley is really our main competition.
Of course, the Valley boys are saying they're going to win anyway. That's your reaction.
Talk is cheap.
The only way tourists can participate in the Junkanoo is to join a special group called the Explorers.
And here's my Junkanoo costume for tonight, delivered to the hotel in a box for $200. You get to keep it and join in the festivities and dancing later. I'm not going to show you mine for the moment. You'll have to wait and see. The rooms are pretty much what you expect. Ensuite bathrooms, twin double beds, all your standard comforts, really. Talking of comfort, time to get 40 winks before this evening's activities begin.
And here I am, fully togged up for the Junkanoo. Now, I'll tell you what, I may look a little bit average, a little bit of a twerp in England, but this works over here. It's the height of fashion, isn't it, Charles?
Sure is. You ready for the parade?
Junkanoo, supposedly named after an African tribal leader called John Canoe, dates from the 18th century, when the slaves had 3 days Christmas holiday. It's held every Boxing Day and New Year, starting at 1 a.m. and going on till dawn.
Despite using all my very best moves all the way through the night, my little group didn't win. Mind you, that's the only disappointment in the most spectacular way I've ever spent New Year's Eve.
So, if you want to join a millennium party you'll remember for 1,000 years, this one might be worth a try.
And we'll have some more suggestions for celebrating the millennium later on in the programme. There are 3 hotels at the Atlantis Resort. All guests have access to all facilities. There are over 30 restaurants and bars to eat in. The cafe offers seafood with views of the underwater ruins of Atlantis. If you're not there for the New Year celebrations, the Junkanoo Expo in Nassau is a museum of costume and parade paraphernalia. 7 nights at the Atlantis Paradise Island cost from £879 per adult and £295 per child, including room only in the beach tower, return scheduled flights with free UK connecting flights from most regional airports, and that's with British Airways Holidays. It's the night celebrations start and computers crash. The new millennium. But do you want to crash out or celebrate with global partygoers? We go round the world in 80 seconds. The new millennium will start here, and that's official. Now, technically speaking, the dawn of the 21st century will start somewhere over the Pacific. But Greenwich is the home of time itself. And to prove it, they're building the world's biggest dome. Well, you could get 2 Wembley stadiums in here, 13 Albert Halls, 18,000 double-decker buses, or 3.8 billion pints of beer. Take your pick, it's big. It's unlikely you're going to get into the New Year's Eve bash attended by the Queen, but the dome will be open every day between 10 and 6, and plans are in hand to turn the Thames and central London that night into the capital's biggest ever party. What's happening elsewhere? Well, how about Sydney, for instance? There'll be 14 kilometres of harbourside fireworks and a long, long night of street entertainment. Or how about Rio? It'll be carnival time all night on Copacabana Beach, where they're expecting 2.5 million people to one of the world's biggest free parties. And what about New York? Giant TV screens will relay celebrations from around the world to day and night revellers in Times Square. Then there's Benidorm, where they always love a good party. Levante Beach will be the setting for concerts, Latin music, rock and roll, and Edinburgh. They'll be the McMother of Hogmanay parties along Prince's Street with limited free tickets from your hotel. Well, if you go out and celebrate on New Year's Eve, it's probably going to cost you a packet because the price of food and drinks are going to be sky high. And I bet you spend the next 2,000 years paying for it.
In the 1970s, it was still something to be a jet-setter. But we all travel by jet nowadays, don't we? So does that mean that everyone can now afford to go to Saint-Tropez?
This is the way to arrive in Saint-Tropez. Somewhat different to the way I arrived for the very first Wish You Were Here programme 25 years ago. I'm a bit different too. But has Saint-Tropez changed from those heady days of the early 1970s when the in crowd made it the place to see and be seen?
On Tahiti Beach, the beautiful people raised eyebrows by going topless. Bridget Bardot adopted the resort as her own and still has a house there. Today, at the height of the season, Tahiti is as smart as ever, but in late summer, it's much quieter. One not entirely welcome change is the rash of new bars and shops along the top of the beach. But the great charm of Saint-Tropez has always been its quayside. The artists are still there, and their models aren't the only ones doing a bit of posing.
In Saint-Tropez, particularly at the height of the season in July and August, some people dress outrageously. They strut their stuff along the quayside here in the old port. They're known as Matthew viewers. Have you seen me's? You're so vain. You probably
think this song is about you. You're so The famous Lescar restaurant has had a facelift since the days when it was a favourite with the Duke of Windsor, and though not cheap, it's surprisingly good value. A 4-course lobster lunch with wine is under £25. One of my favourite corners of Saint-Tropez is Les Places de Lys, a minute's walk from the harbour. And again, the square and its cafes haven't really changed much in 25 years.
This is the famous Café des Arts, or to quote the guidebook, a café of high standing where, until a few years ago, there took place the extravagant nights of the city. And it's still one of the places to come. Now, you can get a cup of coffee and a glass of wine. Each of them would be about £1.40. A good tip, though, if you sit inside, it's half the price.
Not, of course, that the jet set lose much sleep about the extra centime or two when they come down from their villas and hotels in the hills. This is one of the swishiest of the new luxury hotels.
And this is my room, all very elegant and a good size. Lovely fabrics everywhere. And there's a balcony with a view of the Mediterranean. It's worth asking for a view. It makes all the difference. And some of the rooms on the other side of the hotel are quite small.
But there's always been a less expensive way of enjoying Saint-Tropez, and in fact, the whole of the south of France, le camping. Now, I must admit that in those days, it was all pretty basic, particularly le plumbing. Today, however, it's a very different story.
There's plenty of sports facilities if you're quite sporty. There's an outdoor pool, there's tennis courts, the floodlit in the evening. I mean, everything you could want.
Not far from Saint-Tropez is Port Grimaud, the luxury waterside development where Joan Collins has a house.
So, what's happened to Saint-Tropez since I first came here on Wish You Were Here 25 years ago? It used then to be just for the jet-setters, but I've noticed now that it's considerably less exclusive. Having said that, it's got such a lot going for it, and it really does have tremendous charm.
Topless sunbathing was born on the beaches outside town. Beaches are free, but you'll pay around £10 a day for a sun lounger and brolly. If you've got a car, you must get into Saint-Tropez early, no later than 10 o'clock, and leave late. If you're camping and feeding a family, you'll find supermarkets cheaper than at home for most everyday items. Accommodation in Saint-Tropez comes at a price. For example, three nights bed and breakfast at the Hotel Villa Belle Rose costs from £799 per person, including flights and car hire. A 10-minute drive away, you could get a similar package in a three-star hotel from £395, and that's with Magic of France. After the break, it's sand and safari for me in Africa. And fancy Spain in the spring? Martin Roberts does. I'm in a world of superlatives, the highest sand dunes, the oldest deserts, the biggest animals, but also the fewest people. That's in a country full of surprises, Namibia in Southwest Africa.
Well, this is where I spent my first night in Namibia, on a train, going from Windhoek, where I landed, out towards the coast. Now, to be truthful, I don't know an awful lot about this country, so it's going to be a bit of an adventure. Because tourism is very new here, but where do all great adventures start? On trains.
The Desert Express is a new tourist train that crosses one of the world's oldest and driest deserts, the Namib. After 2 days, you end up in the seaside resort of Swakopmund.
Oh, I needed this after that train journey. Bracing, I think, is probably the word. It's absolutely stunning, but this is where people who live here come to cool down. This is the Atlantic, which is freezing cold, and it hits the heat of the desert, and that's why you can see this sort of hazy mist in the background.
Namibia is a former German colony, and here in Swakopmund you can almost be in Germany itself. The buildings look distinctly Bavarian. The locals speak German, drink German lager and eat German pastries. Namibia is four times the size of Britain, with a population less than Glasgow. That's just 2 inhabitants per square kilometre. It's the world's least populated country.
I'm realising very quickly just how big this country is, and wherever you want to go to is literally hundreds of miles apart. This is where we landed from the UK in Windhoek. I've gone across to the coast and are now up in Etosha. I could have driven from the coast to Etosha, but it would have taken me a couple of days. Best way to do it really is to fly. And it's not that expensive, especially if you're travelling and there's say about 4 of you and you split the cost. And with a bit of luck, I'm going to see some brilliant game up here.
Ungava Lodge is a private game reserve right next door to Atosha National Park, one of the largest in Africa. And it's by the waterholes that you've the best chance of seeing the wildlife.
We've waited about an hour for these pair to come down and drink from this water. They have a lot of patience.
Well, it's 7:30 in the morning, which is probably the best time to be out, either early morning or late in the evening. And we're on foot now, and we're actually following some prints of a rhino.
Is it the endangered black rhino or the more common white one?
Over there. You can just see, like, a hop. It's very well disguised, though. I'd have never seen it in a million years. That's why you need a professional.
It took us 3 hours to find the rhinos, the white ones, and 30 seconds for them to spot us, so we didn't hang around. Namibia takes its name from its huge desert, the Namib, where summer daytime temperatures can climb to 40 degrees centigrade and at night they may plunge to below freezing. We're heading for a wilderness camp near Sossusvlei. And it really is the wilderness. The lodges are so private that they don't need curtains. It's the perfect place to chill out and the perfect base to explore an astounding landscape. Sossusvlei is part of the largest nature reserve in Africa. The number of vehicles admitted are restricted and visitors must get permits in advance. No, this is not the latest Namibian fashion statement, but practical desert wear for keeping out the dawn cold in the surreal landscape of the monster dunes.
You see that dune right in the distance there, the highest peak? Well, that is actually the highest dune in the world, and it's called Crazy Dune. And the one that's just in the foreground is the one that I'm going to walk up to. Now, apparently you can do it. The record is 37 minutes. Most people tend to do it in about 3/4 of an hour to an hour. This is like going up an escalator the wrong way, because as fast as you go up, the sand's coming down at you.
The dunes rise to over 300 metres. There's only one way to describe how you feel when you get to the top. King of the sandcastles. And now for the fact file. There are easier ways to go dune bashing. At other big dunes just outside Swakopmund, you can rent a quad bike and try two new sports, sand skiing and dune boarding. Namibia's roads are mostly tarmac, but even gravel roads are smooth with no potholes. If you've time, take an excursion to the Skeleton Coast, where you'll see the half-buried hulks of wrecked ships stranded on the sandbanks. A seven-night package costs from £1,295 per person and includes one night on the Desert Express, four nights in luxury lodges on an all-inclusive basis, two nights bed and breakfast in Windhoek and 6 days car hire, and that's with SAR Travel.
Forget the damp drabness of the beginning of the year in Britain. I'm off on a bargain break to one of Spain's most popular areas to see what it's like without the summer crowds.
For most people, the image of the Costa del Sol is big, brash and busy. But you can enjoy a quieter Costa, like here in Benalmádena, where off-season means you can still enjoy the Costa del Sol sun without it having to Costa pack it.
Not only do you save money by coming this early, but you won't need to reserve a space on the beach. Benalmádena is just down the coast from Torremolinos. It's slightly quieter and more for families, though still fairly noisy and well built up. But just a 10-minute drive inland, you'll find complete tranquility. Benalmádena Pueblo, the original old village, has been dolled up a bit for tourists, but it's still typical of old Spain. While below in the new town, they've just finished building a marina with shops, restaurants and waterside cafes. And this being a Costa, you're never far from life in the fast lane, and the slower one too, at popular Tivoli World.
Well, the easiest and cheapest way to get around here is by bus.
Buenos dias.
Regular services run along the coast road, and you can pick up a timetable from your hotel. I headed for nearby Malaga. Most people only pass through here en route from the airport to their beach hotel. Pity that, because the city has a lot to offer. The Alcazaba is a good place to start. It has great views and a chance to get your bearings. Then you can take a short tour.
It's also a really cheap place to do your food shopping, about half the cost of in the tourist resorts. I mean, look at this, a kilo of strawberries for about 60 pence. Buenos dias, uno kilo? Gracias.
There are some wonderful old cafes and bars and bodegas where you can sample Malaga's famous sweet wine. And if you're feeling peckish, you have to try a Spanish snack.
What is tapas?
Tapas is like a little snack. It's a little dish of something that you have usually before lunch, but you can also have it as a lunch, as a full lunch.
And it's cheap.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's very, very economical. It's local and it's a good chance to try something different and know that you're in Spain.
And another place where you know you're in Spain, at one of the most popular attractions in Torremolinos. The El Ranchito Horse Show is a display of spectacular horsemanship. Back in Benalmádena, it's a tradition on Sundays to eat at one of the seafront restaurants, a perfect place to end my short visit.
Well, this part of the Costa del Sol isn't everybody's cup of tea, but for a good value family holiday, you won't go far wrong.
Let's look at some prices. You'll pay just 78p for the 25-minute bus ride from Benalmádena to Malaga. Buses leave every 15 minutes. A dish of tapas costs around 85 pence to £1.30. Three dishes would probably fill you up, so it's a cheap way of eating. If you want to hire a horse and carriage in Malaga, negotiate first. As a rough guide, you should pay not much more than £9 an hour. 7 nights half-board at the Hotel Porto Benalmádena cost £279 in May, rising to £439 in August, based on two sharing, including return flights and transfers. And that's with Sunset Holidays.